Hello friends, welcome to function 2. So under function 2 we have cargo work. So the first and foremost question is, what is cargo work? So cargo work is nothing but it is the work done by a seafarer in carriage of the cargo from place A to place B. So what does cargo work include? Cargo work includes four basic steps. First and foremost is pre-planning. Okay. Second is safe loading. Number three is safe carriage of the cargo. And number four is safe discharge of the cargo. And this cycle continues, and hence it is called as the life cycle of your cargo work. Okay, again, pre-planning goes, again safe loading, safe carriage and safe discharging. So this is what your cargo work revolves under. Okay, let's begin with pre-planning. What happens in pre-planning? Even before the ship arrives at the port, okay, the planning for the storage of the cargo begins. So what happens is, first and foremost, what you receive on board is the mate's receipt. Mate's receipt comes on board as a email or a fax is sent on board. So the mate's receipt is received by you. So mate's receipt contains the details of the cargo that is to be loaded, or it is a pre-advice of what to expect, okay, the quantity of the cargo which is going to be loaded on board. Okay, so according to the mate's receipt, we plan out the stowage plan. We check the conditions of the hold. Okay, are my holds in good condition or not? The suitability of the hold. Okay, what was my previous cargo? According to it, is the hold suitable or not? Is hold cleaning required or not? Okay, so these all things are done before arriving at port of loading. Okay, so hold preparation is done. We'll be discussing about hold preparation in a separate slide altogether. This is just a brief introduction. So then what we do, we check the stowage space. Stowage space, as well as you check the capacity plan. So whatever the cargo is going to come, the stowage plan is prepared according to the capacity plan. Capacity plan is the plan of the capacities of your hold, which you'll be getting under the stability booklet. So with the help of the stability booklet, you check the capacity plans and accordingly prepare the stowage plan. The stowage plan is either prepared by the chief officer, okay, or it comes pre-planned from the company itself. Whatever the case may be, you'll be using the stowage plan in further. Then securing facilities have to be checked. Are the securing facilities in appropriate good condition or not? Okay, the cranes, your winches, windlasses, are they in proper working condition or not, has to be checked. Okay, the bilges, the bilge pumps are working properly or not. The bilges are cleaned. The bilges have to be cleaned even before the ship arrives at the port of loading. Then the ventilations have to be checked. Your firefighting equipments, your fixed firefighting system have to be tried out. These all things have to be done before the ship arrives at the port of loading. Okay, hence pre-planning. Under pre-planning and pre-arrival itself, we are doing all these things. So once the ship arrives, so what we do once the ship arrives, then we do the assessment. So once the ship assessment, when I talk about assessment, that is during loading, we are assessing the cargo. Whatever the cargo is coming for loading, is it in as per the mate's receipt or not? The conditions which are mentioned under the mate's receipt, that the cargo which we are sending is going to be so and so quantity and so and so quality of the cargo is what we are sending. So we are going to assess that what cargo we are getting is the same quantity and quality of the cargo or not. Okay, if there is some defects, okay, what we'll be doing, we have two options. Either we reject the cargo, or in case we are accepting the cargo, we are going to make a remark about the condition of the cargo that we are accepting it in so and so condition. The remark is a very important point. Okay, under mate's receipt, you have to mention the remark, because the mate receipt has to reflect the actual condition of the cargo that you are loading. Because whatever cargo you are loading is the cargo that you are going to discharge at the discharge port, and then claims would arise if you are going to do a wrong assessment over here. The claims would arise at the discharge port. Okay, so in order to avoid claims, you have to mention the remarks that we have received the cargo in so and so condition. Hence, we check the condition of the cargo, quality of the cargo, test samples are taken. Okay, so these all things will happen during assessment, during the loading assessment. So once this is done, we move on to stowage. The stowage of the cargo has to be in accordance with the stowage plan. The Stoic plan, as I told you, is prepared basically keeping two things in mind. First and foremost is the port of discharge. The port of discharge has to be kept in mind, the port of discharge of the cargo. Which cargo is going to be discharged has to be kept in mind. Also, the capacity plans have to be checked and the codes have to be referred. Various codes have to be referred. For example, the IMDG code has to be referred for your dangerous goods. Under the IMDG code, some segregations and separations are required, which needs to be followed. Similarly, under various codes, those segregations and requirements are there, which need to be followed for the stowage of the cargo. So, safe stowage is completed. Then comes the securing part. Okay. No, the safe stowage is still not completed. Until unless this, your cargo is not secured, your stowage is not completed. So then comes the securing part. The securing has to be done. Now how much securing has to be done? The securing has to be done keeping in mind the roughest weather that you are going to face in your voyage. Because remember that the training that we get over here is you need to be prepared for the worst. So the worst weather that you are going to face during the voyage is to be kept in mind, and the securing has to be accordingly. The securing standard has to be in compliance with your cargo securing manual, either cargo securing manual or the code of safe working practices with respect to your stowage and securing. So these two booklets have to be referred when you are doing securing. So till securing is your loading part, the safe loading is still securing. Once the securing is done, what will happen is the your mate's receipt. The mate's receipt is completed. Now, this mate's receipt is, why is it called a receipt? Because it is presented as a receipt from your side, okay? That we have loaded the cargo in so and so condition. It is signed by the chief mate and it is given back to the shipper. Now, the shipper will acknowledge this receipt that fine, yes, I have given so and so cargo and it is in so and so condition. So the shipper will acknowledge this receipt and give it back to the agent or the ship owner in exchange of the bill of lading. Now, bill of lading is another receipt which describes the quality and quantity of cargo which is totally loaded on board. Okay. Now, the mates, bill of lading will reflect the remarks on the mate's receipt will be reflected on the bill of lading. Okay. This bill of lading is given back to the shipper. Now, bill of lading is basically, bill of lading is the title to the cargo. The holder of bill of lading is the owner of the cargo. And this is a negotiable document in the international market. It can be sold by just signing the document. So, before the cargo reaches the destination or the discharge port, the owner may change. The owner of the cargo may change. So, the bill of lading may exchange various hands. The person who shipped it may not be the same person who might be receiving it. So, bill of lading may change various hands. It is a negotiable document and the cargo can be sold just by signing the bill of lading in name of another person. So, this happens in international market. So, till here, bill of lading was there. Once your loading is completed, another document which is prepared is your cargo manifest. Now, cargo manifest is the document which represents the total cargo on board at any time. So, whatever cargo that you have loaded and where you have loaded, what is the quantity of the cargo that you have loaded over there is present under the cargo manifest. So, why you are preparing this cargo manifest? Cargo manifest is prepared, basically, cargo manifest is prepared for the custom purposes, okay? For custom purposes, we are preparing cargo manifest, but it is also used in various other purposes such as tallying of the cargo, in tallying of the cargo and in identifying where you have stored the cargo. Also, cargo manifest is prepared. You can easily tally the cargo by knowing that so and so bill of lading has come and we have discharged the so and so cargo has been discharged. Just by looking at cargo manifest, you can tally the cargo also. So, cargo manifest does, we'll be discussing about cargo manifest also in a different slide. Next, we'll be moving on to safe carriage. When we talk about safe carriage of the cargo, that is, you need to maintain the condition of the cargo as it is, as you have loaded it, it has to be in that condition. So, what are checks you have to make? Hence, we are going to recheck. So, what are rechecks you will be making? You'll be checking whether the cargo has shifted or not. Okay. The condition of the cargo, is it deteriorating or not? Is it in the appropriate condition as it was loaded? Then you will be checking the ventilation. Is any ventilation required? If there is any ship sweat formation occurring or cargo sweat forming. So accordingly, what kind of ventilation has to be carried out, you'll be checking over here. Then the lashing gear. The lashing that you had done due to rolling and pitching, if this lashing loosens up, you have to tighten these lashings and keep it up to the mark. Okay. So these all checks have to be made during the voyage for the safe carriage of the cargo. Then if there is a refrigerated cargo, you need to check the temperatures. Okay. Same is with the in case of oil or in case of some other liquid chemical, the temperature that needs to be maintained has to be checked. Okay. So these all things have to be kept in mind during the safe carriage of the cargo. Then comes your loose. Okay, cargo manifest. Remember, when you prepare cargo manifest, for IMDG cargo, there is a different cargo manifest prepared along with MSDS, Material Safety Data Sheet. I'm sorry. Then, once safe carriage is completed, we move on to once you reach the port of discharge. What you will be doing is, you will be removing the lashing, loosening and removing of lashing material. Then discharge assessment takes place over here. That under discharge assessment, what we are doing is, again we are assessing the condition of the cargo, the quality, quantity of the cargo, okay, while discharging. That so and so cargo we had received in so and so condition, and we are discharging in so and so condition. And in case there is some damage, a damage report will be made. Remember that a damage report is made both the times, during the assessment of loading assessment and even during discharge assessment. During loading also, the cargo may get damaged during loading also. So a damage report is prepared both the times, during loading as well as discharging. Okay, and then the cargo is safely discharged. Once the cargo is discharged, then again before the next cargo is loaded, you again get the mate's receipt and the cycle continues. So this is basic introduction to cargo work and how it goes on. We'll be discussing about bill of lading and all these documents in the further slides. Hello friends, let's begin with few important definitions which are regularly asked by surveyors in second mate orals. Okay, what I want you to do is remember the diagrams. Okay, have a good look at the diagrams. If you remember the diagrams, I'm sure you can remember the definition from that. Okay, so first and foremost, let's begin with bale capacity. Now remember that bale capacity, grain capacity is what you get. Where will you get these information from? These information you can get from the stability booklet of your ship. Okay, so the capacity plan of the ship also defines the will also give you the bale capacity and your grain capacities. Okay, so the first and foremost definition, what is bale capacity? Before going to the definition, I want you to know what is bale capacity. What is bale capacity? Bale capacity is the capacity of the cargo tank to hold the cargo when they are loaded in form of bales. So what are bales? Bales are nothing but these are gunny bags. Okay. Or for example, bales of cotton. They may be in this shape or in a shape of gunny bag. Okay. They may be in shape of a gunny bag. So these are called bales. So for example, bales of cotton, there may be bales of flowers also. Okay. So the capacity of the cargo tank to hold the cargo when they are loaded in form of bales is known as bale capacity. How will you define this? Remember that bale capacity, when you are loading in bales, how is the loading? The loading will look somewhat like this. So the cargo is loaded within itself. These cargo is not going to penetrate within the frames, right? Hence, the dimensions or the capacity of space that it is going to occupy is within the cargo hold itself. So what we want to do, we have to define this space. So it is nothing but bale capacity is the cubic capacity of the space where the breath is taken from inside of the cargo battens. When I talk about cargo battens, what are these cargo battens? Cargo battens or spar ceilings, they may be called as. These are nothing but these are wooden blocks which are attached to the side frames. These side frames may be your side shell frames or the bulkhead frames. Okay, so these cargo battens or spar ceilings, as you may call it, are there to protect the cargo so that it stays away from the side shell plating or the side frames. Why do you want to do so? the main purpose of your cargo battens or spar ceilings is to avoid the contact of the cargo to the shell plating, because ship sweat may take place and you don't want the cargo to be damaged due to the ship sweat. Also, they provide for the ventilation space also. Because the cargo is away from the ship side, for ventilation also it's quite easy. Hence, these spar ceilings or cargo battens are present. So, bale capacity is the cubic capacity of the space when the breath is taken from inside of the cargo battens to the cargo batten. Okay, the depth is taken from, this is the wooden sheeting, okay, top of the wooden sheeting on the tank top, this is the tank top, so the top of the wooden sheeting on the tank top to the underside of the deck beam. When I talk about underside, this is the deck beam and this portion is the underside of the deck beam. So the depth is taken from top of the wooden sheeting to underside of the deck beam, and the length is taken from inside of the, so this is the bulkhead, the vertical divisions. So inside of the bulkhead stiffness or spar ceilings if they are fitted. So from spar ceiling to spar ceiling. So that would be the length. Okay. So this is what bale capacity is. Let's define bale capacity once again. Bale capacity is nothing but, it is the cubic capacity of the space when the breadth is taken from inside of the cargo battens, the depth is taken from top of the wooden sheeting to the underside of the deck beams, okay, and the length is taken from inside of the bulkhead stiffness or spar ceilings if they are fitted. So this is what your bale capacity is. Coming to the grain capacity. So I hope you all can define grain capacity now. Once you have basic knowledge of what bale capacity is, grain capacity is what? Grain capacity is the capacity of the cargo tank to hold the cargo when they are loaded in form of grains or when a bulk loading is done. Okay, you load the cargo in the form itself, the grains itself. So what will happen when you are loading grains? What is going to happen? The grain is going to get dissipated and penetrate within the frames also, right? So you want the dimensions to be taken till the plating, and plus additionally what you have to do in order to get the exact cubic capacity of the space that the grain is occupying, you have to provide for the alloyance of the framings, those are present over here. Okay, so let's define what grain capacity is. It is the cubic capacity. See, grain capacity is going to look somewhat like this. Okay. Frames may be present, but the cargo is going to dissipate totally. Okay, it's going to penetrate in all directions. So it is the cubic capacity of the space where the length, breadth, and depth are taken right to the plating. Okay, and allowance is made for the frames that are present. Okay, so this is what grain capacity is. Coming to our next definition, which is density. What is density? Density, we all know what is the formula for density. Density equals mass by volume. So it is the mass occupied by mass of a substance per unit volume. That is tons per cubic meter. So mass of a substance per unit volume is its density. What is the reciprocal of density is known as stowage factor. So what is the SI unit of stowage factor? It is cubic meters per ton. Let's define stowage factor. Stowage factor is the volume occupied by a unit ton of a cargo. So for example, this is taken as a unit ton of a cargo and this is the cargo hold. So the volume that this cargo is occupying, okay, the volume occupied by a unit ton of cargo is its stowage factor. So this is the stowage factor of this particular cargo. So this is the stowage factor of this particular cargo. Okay. Next is broken stowage. Now what is broken stowage? Broken stowage, this space is what you are seeing between the packages. The spaces which are left between these packages are, or the spaces that are left between these packages are known as broken stowage. Okay. Another important point to be noted is that broken stowage is always calculated as the percentage of the volume of the cargo. Percentage of the volume of the cargo and not of the space that it is stored in. So always remember that broken stowage is calculated as percentage of the total volume of the cargo that is loaded and not of the space that it is stored in. Okay, so hence percentage, when you take percentage, it would be percentage of the stowage factor, because that would be the total volume. When you calculate the total volume of the cargo that is loaded, would be according to the stowage factor. So that is broken stowage. Hence what you will be getting is the total space that is occupied by the cargo would be achieved. How we will be knowing it is with the help of stowage factor and the broken stowage. So adding the stowage factor and the broken stowage, you will get the total space occupied by the cargo. Okay, so this is how we know that how much of the cargo can be loaded within a hold. So this is how you are going to do it. Then our next definition is load density. What is load density? Load density, when you hear the term load density, some weight should come in your mind. Okay, so load density, how I remember the definition of load density is by remembering the SI unit. The SI unit for load density is tons per meter square. It is nothing but it is the amount of weight that can be safely loaded. When I talk about amount of weight, it comes under tons. Amount of weight that can be safely loaded per unit area. Per unit area is determined with the help of meter square. So amount of weight that can be loaded, that can be safely loaded per unit area. Okay, sorry, it is the maximum weight. Sorry, it is the maximum weight that can be loaded safely per unit area is what load density is. So the definition of load density is it is the maximum weight that can be safely loaded per unit area. So what is the use of load density? Load density helps you to determine the amount of cargo that can be loaded with under that area. Okay, with the help of load density, you can determine to what height you are going to load the cargo. Okay, whether the cargo is a dead weight cargo or a measurement cargo, because as according to the density you are going to decide upon. Because if the load density is higher, what will happen? The deck would break. Okay, the tank top would break down. If your load density of the cargo exceeds the load density of the deck, okay, if the weight of the cargo exceeds the load density of the deck, then the damages may occur. Hence, to avoid this, you have to make the calculations accordingly. Then we have cargo. Cargo, under cargo, we have deadweight cargo, measurement cargo, and optional cargo. So what is deadweight cargo? Now remember that deadweight cargoes are the cargoes on which freight is charged according to the weight of the cargo. As per the weight of the cargo, these are usually high density cargoes. They occupy less space, okay, but they are greater in weight. Hence they are high density cargoes. They come under deadweight cargoes and they are termed as deadweight cargoes. For example, iron ore, okay, the rolls of iron. Iron ore is a deadweight cargo. Then comes measurement cargo. What is measurement cargo? Measurement cargoes are those cargoes on which freight is charged according to the volume occupied by the cargo. For example, cotton. Bales of cotton, it is the measure. Bales of cotton is an example for the measurement cargo on which freight is charged according to the space which is occupied by the cargo, okay, and not on the weight of the cargo. Then comes optional cargo. Look at the term, the answer is within the term itself. When we talk about optional cargo, now optional cargo, why is it termed as optional cargo? Because the shipper has the option. Shipper, when he is shipping such a type of cargo, okay, remember optional cargo, the storage plan of the optional cargo has to be done very carefully because you are not certain about the port of discharge. Okay, but you are certain in one thing, that it is not the exact discharge port, it is going to be before that itself. So optional cargo is the cargo on which the destination or the discharge port is not decided. Okay, you have the option of discharging the cargo on at either of the ports. Okay, I'll give you an example. For example, the ship is starting the voyage from Djibouti to Bahrain. Okay, you are starting the voyage from Djibouti to Bahrain. In between, you have Oman, you have Sharjah, you have Jebel Ali. Okay, the shipper has shipped the cargo for either Oman, Sharjah or Jebel Ali. Okay, so Oman, Sharjah and Jebel Ali are the optional ports for which the cargo is loaded. Okay, but the confirmation would be given to you before the ship reaches the discharge port. This is the discharge port. Before the ship reaches the discharge port itself, you'll be given the confirmation about where you have to discharge the optional cargo. Hence, such type of a cargo is called optional cargo and such type of a port is called optional port. So this is about optional cargo and optional port, and these are few definitions you need to remember. I hope if you are clear with the diagrams, I'm 100% sure you will be able to give the answers of the definition. So all the best and do good.